Okay, good morning, everybody. Okay. My name is Peter Schuck, as Angela just told you. My institute is in Paris, Orsay, Institut de Physique Nucléaire. I have a second institute where I switch a couple of days per week, which is Laboratoire de Méthode en Physique de Matière Condensée in Grenoble. So there I do mostly cold atom physics, and in Paris, nuclear physics. And as Angela just mentioned, in 1980, I wrote with a colleague of mine a book which is called The Nuclear Many-Body Problem. The nuclear many-body problem. The body problem. Problem. And it is my co-author Peter Ring. Peter Ring. And myself, Peter Schuck. So it's appeared in Springer Verlag, 1980. So it's has become a book which is pretty well used in the community, students, even researchers. I have to take this off. Tricky now. Okay. So I have in my career mostly be working with the many-body problem, specifically the nuclear many-body problem. And since about good 15 years, I'm very much involved in nuclear cluster physics, mostly alpha particles, maybe heavier clusters, and alpha particle condensation. Alpha particles are kind of boson, which can eventually condensate, and we will talk about this quite a bit during the lectures. And okay, let me start some outline program. I will start with general aspects of nuclear physics, mostly from the theory point of view. I'll introduce what is a cluster, alpha cluster, then condensation phenomena in nuclear matter, then come to finite nuclei, talk about the Hoyle state in quorum 12. I don't know whether you've heard of this. Analogous states in oxygen 16, neon 20, and so on. We will talk about theoretical methods, and so on. I have not had space here to outline everything. So some basic, I mean, I guess you are not all familiar with nuclear physics, so I may start with some basic aspects. What is a nucleus? Well, a nucleus, you probably know, is built out of protons and neutrons, protons, neutrons, and so forth. And depending on the size of the nucleus, you have A nucleons and N neutrons and Z protons. So the nuclear density, if you make a crosscut through a nucleus as a function of the radius, the density rho of R is something like that. It has a flat portion like a like a droplet, a water droplet, and which is usually called, I mean, there are wiggles around because of so-called shell defects, but on average, one calls this flat portion the saturation density, which is about point rho zero is about 0.16 Fermi minus 3. And there's some fall off width, which is maybe 10% is about 2 Fermi. So these are such basic things which one should know. One should maybe also know that even already the nucleon itself is a cluster, namely a cluster of 3 quarks. So let's take a nucleon here. You have 3 quarks in there, so it's a strongly bound cluster already. We will not talk about this kind of clusters here. We will restrict ourselves to nuclear physics. But you should keep that in mind, that in nuclear physics, there is a strong aspect of clustering. In other domains of physics, cluster physics is not so much developed. There are in condensed metaphysics, there are excitons, bi-excitons, and so forth, and so that different kinds of clusters. In cold atom physics, they see clusters, but only very recently. So the domain of nuclear physics with clusters of 3 quarks or alpha particles of 4 nucleons is a domain where cluster physics is very well developed and very important. So since we will talk a lot about the alpha particles, let me tell you what it is, an alpha particle. And usually you have something like a mean field potential. I will talk more about what the mean field potential is. Let's say mean field potential is something like a harmonic oscillator. You have a zero S state and a zero P state. This is a S wave. And since an alpha particle has 2 neutrons and 2 protons, spin up, spin down each, you can put 2 neutrons and 2 protons in the lowest state. So you have spin up, spin down, spin up, spin down. One calls this, if a shell is full, doubly magic nucleus. So the alpha particles is the lightest doubly magic nucleus. You have a next doubly magic nucleus. When you fill in here this P shell, you can here put 12 nucleons. P shell is L equals 1. So the degeneracy is 2 times L plus 1, 4 times 4, 2 spins of protons, 2 spins of makes 12 here. 12 plus 4 is 16. And then you come to oxygen 16, which is the next heavy doubly magic nucleus. But we'll talk about oxygen 16 a little bit later. So why is such a doubly magic nucleus, or proton and neutrons? I mean, we must realize that why the cluster physics for nuclei is so important is the fact that we have 4 different fermions. It's a very rare situation, actually, in all fields of physics, that we have more than 2 different fermions. In electron gas, you have electrons, spin up, spin down. You have other system, even called atom systems, or always you have more or less only 2 types of fermions. But in nuclear physics, we have 4 types of fermions. Protons spin up, neutrons spin up, down. And so we can put 4 nucleons. And this makes that the alpha particle is very stable. It has a binding energy per particle which is almost as strong already as the strongest bound nucleus, which is iron, which has about 8.5 MeV binding energy. So as such a light nucleus, this is a very exceptionally strongly bound. Since it has a total spin zero, total spin, you know that spin zero particles are boson type of particles and spin half particles are fermion type of particles. So since it's a spin zero particle, it is boson-like. And as a boson, you'll see there may be condensation phenomena and so forth. So if you had only four neutrons, I mean, there's also neutron matter. For example, in neutron stars, you have neutron matter. If you had only neutrons, you immediately will see that here you can only put two neutrons, spin up, spin down, the ones which we have already here. And the other ones you had to put here in the upper shell. So this is energetically, since the difference between the two states is about almost 20 MeV, it's energetically very penalizing. So finite systems of neutrons do not exist. I mean, today there are some rumors going that people see some resonance of four neutrons, but I don't believe to it that there's some reality. So neutron matter, also, if you put infinite number of neutrons, is unstable, is not bound. In neutron stars, they are, as the name says, it's built out of neutrons, essentially. But the neutron stars, the neutrons in the neutron star is kept by gravity. So there is a Fermi gas of neutrons, but it's more complicated than a simple Fermi gas. But you see already with this simple example that only neutrons is energetically very unfavored. So, as I said, what makes the alpha particle again more boson-like is the fact that if you excite, this is about 20 MeV, the first excited state of the alpha particle lies about the alpha excited state around 20 MeV. This is by factors higher, so it's a very stiff particle. This is by factors higher than any other nucleus. So, for example, oxygen 16 has its first excited state at 6 MeV, roughly. So it's very hard to excite the alpha particle. So it makes it also to be a rather good boson. So what else? Of course, we have also other clusters, like a deuteron. Deuteron is a bound state of a neutron and a proton, has energy per particle around 1.1 MeV. So it's about a factor 7 less bound than the alpha particle. So it's a dimer, which is very little bound. But neutron-proton pairs eventually can give rise, it's also a boson type of particle, can give rise to superfluidity. We will come to that later. I mean, the alpha particle is also bound more strongly than the deuteron by the simple fact that you can have six bounds with respect to. So it makes it really a strongly bound particle. What to tell you still before I come to the details in the nuclear matter? Well, let me right away talk about the two alpha particle system. The two alpha particle system is beryllium-8. So maybe you have noted it down. So the two alpha particle system, alpha alpha is beryllium 8. It is almost bound. It's not really bound. It's slightly in the continuum. What happens if two closed shell nuclei want to fuse? I mean, they are very stiff. Nuclear forces are attractive. So if they come from the outside, the two alphas have to climb the Coulomb repulsion. I mean, alpha particles are charged, positively charged, so both repel each other at long distances. But once they come in contact, the short-range nuclear force makes them bound somewhere. Well, it's not well drawn, this figure. It should be, of course, eventually a little deeper than the zero here. That's what one calls the Coulomb barrier. The beryllium 8 is almost bound, not quite. It has a resonance here at 92 kV. So above the threshold energy. So to decay, it has to tunnel through the whole barrier, which is very wide. So there's a nuclear tunneling process. And because it's very difficult to tunnel through the barrier, the lifetime of beryllium 8 is very long on nuclear scales. It has a width of EV of order electron volt, which is condensed matter scales. Nuclear scales are million electron volts, so it's a and has a lifetime 10 to minus 17 seconds. It's very long on nuclear scales, which are typically 10 to the minus 21 seconds. But of course, on daily life scales, 10 to the minus 7 is still very short-lived. So maybe I can show you a picture of beryllium 8. Well, here I repeat a little bit what I told you about in a little bit nicer view graph, the different aspects. Do I have a pointer here? Yes. Deuteron, alpha particle, four neutrons, and binding energy, of course. So, well, to the Ikeda diagram, we will maybe come later. Wait, let me concentrate. Yes, here. This is a sort of exact Monte Carlo calculation of beryllium 8. You see the strong cluster configuration of beryllium 8 with two alphas. On the left-hand side, of course, the beryllium 8 has also J equals 0 in its ground state. So you have to turn it in space to make it spherical. But in the in the intrinsic frame, you have two pronounced alpha particles, almost stable particles. We should be strongly aware of the fact that this is the only nucleus which has in its ground state such a pronounced alpha particle configuration. If we put a third alpha particle on the side of beryllium 8, we know this is then three alpha particles. This is carbon 12. And we know that carbon 12 in its ground state collapses to a Fermi gas. What is a Fermi gas? Fermi gas is essentially Slater determinant, mean field. Where can I put maybe here? So you know, there is a strong difference between, I think you know all this, but let me repeat it, a strong difference between bosons and fermions. Fermions, if you have levels, you have to put up to such degeneracies of spin up, spin down, you have to put one, you have only one fermion per state. You can only put one fermion per state, right? Whereas bosons, you can put as many bosons in a state as you like, and if you have. So if you have a boson system of bosons, you can put all the bosons in the lowest state. So this is the strong difference between bosons and fermions. So an independent particle state of fermions, they have to be anti-symmetrized, usually in a condensed matter, for example, or in a nuclear matter. The states, the free states, are plane waves. So you have to construct a Slater determinant of an anti-symmetrized product of phi R1, phi 2 R2, and so forth, is up to n particles, or let's call it A, RA, vector, and spin indices, of course. And this is called a Slater determinant. Slater determinant, you can have pure plane waves, so phi 1 is proportional to the IIP 1 R1. But in a finite nucleus, of course, you have not plane waves. If you have a finite nucleus, it's contained in a mean field, what one calls a mean field. What is a mean field? It's the average potential which fills one nucleus in the soup of the other nucleus, so nuclei. So let me say, what is a mean field? Classically speaking, a mean field of particle I is you sum over all j's not equal to I of the two particle force AI minus RJ, right? You sum just all, if you have here a particle and you have other ones, you sum all the interactions which act of the other nuclei on the nucleus, on the nuclei. But of course, a nucleus is not a classical object. A nucleus is a quantum object, so each particle J here has a probability of presence. So this is classical, but quantally you must have a sum over J and equals I integral. You have to average out of the on the probability of presence. These three are E of Ri minus R, and you average over the particle J R squared. So this is the probability of presence of one of the nucleons in the Slater determinant, and this is this quantum mean field, what one calls the Hartree term, Hartree of R I. Because of the exchange, there are also Fock terms, but I don't have time and don't want to go into all these details. But you must know and keep in your mind that a lowest approximation to a nucleus or any many body problem is actually the so-called mean field. A cartoon of a mean field for a small particle like an alpha particle is the harmonic oscillator. I mean, here comes, of course, a Schrödinger equation, which is minus h bar squared over 2m Laplacian plus this Hartree or Hartree-Fock mean field, of R and phi I is equal to epsilon I phi I. And you have to solve this equation, and this is usually a nonlinear equation. As you can see, you have to calculate the eigenfunctions and the eigenvalues of this Schrödinger equation, and the mean field Hartree-Fock potential depends quadratically again on the eigen. So I think if I give here a nuclear physics course and you're not all nuclear physicists, I have to tell you that, and this, actually probably you know it, quite a general many-body approach, which is the mean field approach. By the way, if you have questions, don't hesitate to ask any question if it's not clear for you. So again, this is a Slater determinant. You can write this Slater determinant also in another form, because it's very convenient to write it as phi 1 R1 up to phi 1 Rn, and down phi n R1 up to phi n Rn. And if you work out this determinant, you just have an anti-symmetrized product of the single particle. So this you should also know. So what else should I tell you before I come to more detailed things in the nuclear matter? I first want to treat nuclear matter. I think that's about all. You have to remember that fermions, in principle, are occupying up the ladder, one fermion per state. If you have a spin degeneracy, you can put more in one state, but essentially it's that. Or if you have angular momentum degeneracy. Bosons all can go in the lowest state. There's no exclusion principle. Boson wave functions must be symmetrized completely. Fermion wave functions must be anti-symmetrized completely. And we have in nuclei, we have fermions. But as you will see, in nuclei we have also alpha particles, and they are bosons, essentially. Okay, let us come to first to alpha particles in nuclear matter. Alpha particles in nuclear matter, let me see where I can erase this. Also erase this. Okay, in fermion systems, very often there happens what you know probably from metals. If there's attraction between two fermions with spin up, spin down, you can have the phenomenon in metals of superconductivity. And in nuclei or in nuclear matter, the same phenomenon consists in superfluidity. So to understand later what happens with the alpha particles, I first want to treat the case of the deuteron. Deuteron in a nuclear matter, and see how it comes about that we can have superfluidity. Well, let me write down two-particle Schrödinger equation in nuclear matter. So it's eigenvalue minus epsilon pi p1 epsilon p2, which are the kinetic energies essentially up eventually to a Hartree-Fock term, which in infinite matter also does not depend on the position, of course, because it's completely homogeneous, but it can depend on momentum. So you have an eigenfunction p1 p2 is equal Well, let me write down P1 prime, P2 prime. I write down the Schrödinger equation in momentum space. It's P1, P2, V, P1 prime, P2 prime, psi, P1 prime, P2 prime. So the P's are momenta, contain eventually also the spin, and isospin. We call proton, neutron, we call isospin. Isospin up is proton, isospin down is neutron. But of course, if we have such a two-particle Schrödinger equation in momentum space, because the Fermi C is filled in nuclear matter, you have a dense system of states, which are all momentum states, because you have translational invariance. And in nuclear matter, at equilibrium, the states are all filled up to what one calls the Fermi energy. So, since all the states are filled in a two-particle scattering event, the two particles cannot scatter into already occupied states. Clear? Because this is forbidden by the Pauli principle. So you have to put here what one calls the Pauli blocking factors, epsilon P1 minus mu or epsilon F. The nomenclature is not very, one calls it often also the chemical potential here, times theta of epsilon P2 minus mu. And this matrix element is essentially more or less is directly related to the two-particle force. You have a momentum-conserving delta function, P1 plus P2. The two incoming particle momenta must be equal to the two outgoing momenta, P2 prime, and times the relative momenta between two incoming particles, P2. I'm a bit sloppy with the spin indices. Just think of the spin indices yourself. It takes too much time here to write down everything. So this is a scattering. This is graphically the interaction vertex. And this is just the Fourier transform into momentum space of the usual two-body interaction or the two-body force, right? So we have a Schrödinger equation, which is not exactly the free Schrödinger equation, because the two-particle scattering process occurs inside a meta, a fermionic meta, where the states are already occupied up to the Fermi energy. Let us generalize this to finite temperature. At finite temperature, you know what these step functions are related to. So these step functions exclude all states when I call these things occupation numbers, P1 and P's. They are empty up to zero here, up to the Fermi energy, and then you can occupy, you can scatter into these states. So at finite temperature, you have the mu minus epsilon p, you can write it as 1 minus theta of epsilon p minus mu, and this at finite temperature is nothing else than the Fermi-Dirac distribution, which you probably know from your elementary courses. At finite temperature, this is just then f of epsilon p is equal to 1 over e to the epsilon p minus mu over t. So at finite temperature, this just gets a little bit rounded here, depending on the temperature. So at final temperature, and that's where I want to discuss the transition to superconductivity or superfluidity. You have to take this as Fermi functions. Actually, at 1 minus F1 times 1 minus F2. And these F1s are just the Fermi function of particle 1 and particle 2, right? Usually one abbreviates this as F1 bar and this as F2 bar. Now, in a Fermi system, usually the ground state is already a little bit correlated, so that it is not directly a step function. So if you put in correlations, there is some blurring of the step function. It still makes a jump here in correlated systems, which goes beyond the mean field approximation, which is not Slater determinant. So since there are also some empty spaces for the holes, usually one then also allows for hole occupations, then you have a phase space factor, as one says, F1, F2 minus F1, F2, which are the ones which are at zero temperature. In principle, also already occupied, but since it's a little bit emptied and a little bit states above, you can also have hole occupancies. And this factor, if you multiply it out, it's just 1 minus F1 minus F2. And this is the famous blocking term for two-particle scattering in any, let's say, hot Fermi gas for two-particle scattering. So this equation has been considered by Cooper very early. I don't know which year it was, 1956 or something like that. And he has then found that there is a state if in the solution of this equation which is lower than the two-particle state, which is lower than the Fermi energy. So if you call this epsilon F or equal mu, he found that the solution at a certain critical temperature has an eigenvalue which is below 2 times mu. So if you create a state which is below a two-particle state, which has a energy which is below 2 times the Fermi energy, of course, all the particles want to gain energy in getting over into this bound state. So anyway, this is what one calls the Saulis criterion for the onset of superconductivity or superfluidity. We will then take this over to the alpha particle condensation, but let me just write down offhand such a condensation wave function, which everybody can understand. I will not go into the details of any of this. If you have deuterons, let's say very low density gas of deuterons, and so forth, proton, bound state of proton and neutrons. If the deuterons are very far away from one another, Pauli principle is not active, right? So you can write down, actually, in an infinite gas, very easily the ground state. This is proportional to a deuteron wave function R1 minus R2, eventually center of mass phi deuteron R3 minus R4 and so forth, phi deuteron, say R n minus 1 up to R n, all vectors, of course, and one wave function of the deuteron, phi deuteron, R 1 2 R 1 minus R 2 is equal e to the I center of mass momentum, center of mass position, and a relative wave function R 1 minus R 2. Right now, as we said before, bosons condense in the lowest state, and in infinite matter, the lowest state has what kind of momentum? Total momentum? Zero. Right. So this factor goes away, and you have a product state of deuterons. If the deuterons are far away from us, so it must be very low density. But of course, if they come a little bit closer, you must anti-symmetrize this still. Pauli principle may still be active. So you get the anti-symmetrized product of such superwave functions. And this is essentially, I don't have time to go into details, essentially the famous BCS wave function of Bardeen, Cooper, and Schrieffer, who invented such a nice theory to explain superconductivity in 1900 and something, 1900, maybe 52 or 56. I forgot. And this theory came out after Cooper explained that in a two-particle scattering event, there is a tendency that these two particles form a bound state below the 2 mu threshold. And then, so this was a very famous step in many body physics to explain. And you should realize that condensation phenomena in quantum physics are one of the most spectacular phenomena. I mean, superconductivity and superfluidity. This is something which is very spectacular, of course. Okay, yes. What shall I do next? I should still explain a little bit what is going on with this superfluidity. Superfluidity, yeah, I can erase this. I mean, there are special techniques to make calculations with these wave functions. I have no time here, and it's not the purpose of these lectures to explain the BCS theory in detail. I mean, I think it's very straightforward to write down such an anti-symmetrized wave function of deuteron wave function or pairs of any spin-up, spin-down wave functions. But if you actually, it turned out that for deuterons or electron pairs, this wave function is even valid for systems which are denser, where the states overlap strongly and mix strongly, and superfluidity or superconductivity that does not go away even if they are strongly intermingled. And this was the great discovery actually of Bardeen, Cooper, and Schrieffer. But if you have occupation numbers, if you trace the wave function of the deuteron in momentum space, you may have such a wave function, something like a Gaussian. If you squeeze the system, this will get bigger and bigger, and you know that it cannot per state per spin, the occupancy in phase space cannot go beyond one. So if you squeeze, the occupation here in phase space gets higher and higher, but at a certain moment it will hit one. And then it cannot go beyond. It goes on and on and on. So finally, this is a famous expression of of BCS theory that you have such smeared out distributions. You may know this because this is clearly in all systems. So one point I want to make clear in these lectures is the following. Maybe I have here, yeah, here I have the cartoon again. This is a many-body phenomenon which has in the recent years discussed very much in nuclear physics, in condensed matter physics, that from such a pair wave function, which are deuteron, let's say deuteron wave function, which are far apart, which is a Bose-Einstein condensate, BEC, if you squeeze it, it goes over to the BCS state, which is still some sort of intermingled boson type of states, but it's strongly intermingled. It's still completely anti-symmetrized because of the anti-symmetrizer here. And from one side to the other, here the chemical potential is negative because it's a bound state. To take out one neutron or one proton from the deuteron, you need energy minus 1.1 MeV. Whereas here, chemical potential becomes positive, and still the correlations between proton and neutron makes it that this state gives rise to superfluidity. So this transition from here has been very much studied in recent years in condensed matter and nuclear matter and so forth. So this is a crossover which is continuous from the Bose-Einstein condensate side to what one calls the BCS side. And you should know that in an electron, in a metal, the size of one correlated electron spin-up, spin-down pairs goes over hundreds of sites in the metal. So these are several hundreds of angstrom long, these correlated pairs, and are all intermingled and so forth. In nuclear physics, it's more on this side, but not completely. It's still intermingled and gives rise to superfluidity. And one has strong manifestations in nuclei of superfluidity, in deformed nuclei. For the moment of inertia, it's like you have an ellipsoid full of water and you turn it, and it's not the same moment of inertia if the water is in there, if it is an ice cube, because ice cube has a strong moment of inertia. If water is in there, the inscribed sphere does not turn around with the whole thing. So this is for superfluidity. What happens for alpha particles or for quartets in general? Of course, if the alpha particles are far away, you have, again, a Bose-Einstein condensate. But if the alpha particles, if you squeeze it, you don't have the same phenomenon as for deuterons or for pairs of electrons. If you squeeze it, you don't have the same phenomenon that what one says, the size or the coherence length of these quartet objects get bigger and bigger and get intermingled and get still anti-symmetrized. So there's a strong difference between a two-particle system and any other particle higher than two system at higher densities where the chemical potential passes from negative to positive. The positive side for alpha particles or quartets or any higher cluster does not exist like in BCS. And actually, I will give you a homework to do. I will explain in a minute why this is so qualitatively, and I give you homework to show this, why this comes about. Okay, so far so good. Let me go on. Well, let us go on. I told you how to calculate the critical temperature for the onset of superfluidity of two particles, or this was the so-called in-medium two-particle Schrödinger equations with the Pauli blockers. Let us write down the analogous equation for the alpha particle. Of course, much more complicated. This is a four-body Schrödinger equation, but let me write it out anyway. It's the eigenvalue, something, can put an index here, minus epsilon 1, minus epsilon 2, minus epsilon 3, minus epsilon 4. These are all kinetic energies in shorthand, notation is equal. We have the same Pauli blocking factors as before, 1 minus F2, 2, and then we have the matrix element. Let us call it V1 prime 2 prime, and the wave function 1 prime 2 prime, it must be summed over, of course. I hope that I put the summation in the 3, 4. So the two-particle interaction, of course, can only hit a pair of the four particles. So it goes something like this. You have a four-particle propagator. And this can hit, the interaction can hit in the upper two, and of course can hit also in the lower two, and only there are six combinations where the two particle can be attached to a pair of the four. So 3 times 4, half is 6. So this, let us write down another one, 1 minus F1 minus F3 sum over 1 prime 3 prime V 1 3 1 prime 3 prime Psi 1 prime 2 3 prime 4 and so forth. You can easily check that you have 6 combinations here. Now we can ask the question, at which temperature, which is contained in these Fermi functions, you can eventually have an eigenvalue which is equal to 4 times mu, 4 times this chemical potential. At finite temperature, one has not the Fermi energy, one has a chemical potential. And actually, it exists. There exists a critical temperature where the eigenvalue has exactly 4 times the chemical potential. And if you go lower in the temperature, it gets below the critical energy, 4 times mu, and then one can, as in the two-particle case, suppose that these alpha particles or quartets go into a superfluid state. Okay. Yes, I should not. Okay, with the alpha particles in the low density, regime, it's very analogous. We can write down such an anti-symmetrized wave function for the alpha condensate. This is proportional to an anti-symmetrizer. We have a wave function alpha R1 up to R4, phi R5 up to R8, and so forth up to as many alpha particles you have there. So if the alpha particles are far apart from one another, as in the lower part of the view graph, there's no question that you have alpha particles here, the same wave function, just a product. If they come closer, the anti-symmetrizer, of course, works, and we have to see what happens if the alpha particles overlap. And as I told you, it for the alpha particles cannot happen like it was the case for superconductivity or superfluidity, that you have a dense system where the two-body wave functions are intermingled very strongly. On the contrary, if the alpha particle starts to strongly overlap, this alpha particle condensate state is destroyed. And I would like to tell you a little bit what is the reason for that. The reason for that has to do with the level density, and this I will give you as a homework. Let us consider level density in the two-particle case and in the four-particle case. So in the two-particle case, level density, two fermion of energy. So in the medium, of course, you can have only the two particles again be above the Fermi energy. So you have sum over center of mass and relative momenta, theta, or let's call it again P1 and P2. Again, C epsilon P1 minus mu, theta epsilon P2 minus mu times energy conserving delta function minus epsilon P1 minus epsilon P2. So this is a Dirac delta function. Usually level density is defined for one particle system is sum over I delta E minus epsilon I. Why is this counting the number of levels? Well, if you have delta peaks, so you sum up all these delta peaks, you get the number of states per energy. So if this is a continuum like in a homogeneous matter, this becomes an integral over momenta, and you can calculate this. But for the two-particle case, you have to take care of these Pauli blocking factors, that you only have a level density above, like in the Schrödinger equation. And you can imagine that such a level density plays an essential role in the solution of the two-body Schrödinger equation, right? Without level density, you cannot have any two-body state there. So in the case that the total momentum P1 plus P2 is equal zero, I will ask you in the homework to calculate the level density and to show that this level density at 2 times mu g of two particles as a function of E actually starts with a finite value. Here this is a finite value, and you can calculate also the level density, by the way, below. And of course at zero it goes to zero, there's no energy, there are no levels. So then we calculate the same thing for the four particles. Well, the four particles. You calculate four particles, g of four particles is equal to sum over, of course, P1, P2, P3, P4, and then theta, let me call it theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, theta 4, delta E minus epsilon 1, minus epsilon 2, minus epsilon 3, minus epsilon 4. So this is just the generalization to the four-body case. And now I would like that you show for the four-particle case that actually the level density at E equals 4 mu goes to zero. There's a strong difference between the four-particle case. Of course, summation under the condition that the total momentum P1 plus P2 plus P3, P4 is equal to zero. The condensation phenomenon occurs always when the cluster is at zero, at least in infinite matter, right? So as we have seen, condensation goes always in the lowest quantum state, and in infinite matter, the lowest quantum state is the monomentum zero. So that is a homework to do, that you show, and I give you some hints, that in the two-particle case, for total momentum equals zero, the level density is finite, and for four particles, the level density goes to zero. And of course, mu should be positive. It should be already in a stage where the particles, the alpha particles, get denser, like for the deuterons. The chemical potential passes from negative, where it is binding when the deuterons are far apart. It has the binding energy of each deuteron. If they get denser, the chemical potential passes from negative to positive. And of course, here always I want also to have the condition that the mu is positive. So under these conditions, and as for the four-particle case, as soon as the chemical potential or the binding of the alpha particles goes from really binding, where the chemical potential is negative, to slightly positive, immediately the level density switches to zero. And of course, where there is no level density, there's no alpha particle and there's no condensation. So I would like to work a little bit on this aspect, which is a very important and instructive aspect. I can show you a result of a calculation where this is shown. I have to go ahead here, yes. Forget about the two left rows. This is the single particle occupation as we had for the, well, it's erased. You remember the single particle occupations for the pairs, which are in the BCS regime, something like that. And if the deuterons are far apart, it goes like this. You remember this? This is a free deuteron. This is when the deuterons get denser and denser, finally goes over to a BCS occupation. Here, these are called row of K's for some historical reason. These are the occupation numbers for a chemical potential, which is rather negative still. You remember free alpha particle has -7 chemical potential around, and then you go up in density, the mu goes less negative, and here we are with the mu slightly positive, very slightly positive, and still you have occupation number, but the occupation number only goes up to 0.35. So we are only here, more or less. And then it turns out that your four-body equation has no solution anymore. You cannot go further in the density. Higher mu's means higher densities. There's a relation. I will show you. And so that the fact that you have no level density fully comes into operation here. You cannot go beyond. And there is no regime where this comes up to 1. You see it's lower, 0.1, 0.2, 5, 3, 5. But it is far away from going up to full occupancy in the phase space. And already very early at very low densities, the quartet or alpha particle condensation breaks down. And if you look at the density where it breaks down, is essentially where the alpha particles with the surfaces start to essentially overlap. So as soon as there's overlap in density with the alpha particles, the condensation is gone. And this is so for any clusters. If you have alpha particles or heavier clusters or whatever, you should remember that level density, besides the one particle level density and the two particle level density for the two particles at rest, all level densities go through zero at the Fermi energy. And there is one further famous example in Fermi liquid theory. Namely, you know eventually that in Fermi liquid theory, a particle which moves with the Fermi velocity at the just at the Fermi level has infinite mean free path length. So it travels without any collisions. This comes also from the Pauli principle. And what enters there is a level density of the two particle two hole. If there comes a particle and you scatter, it goes over into a two particle one hole doorway state. And if you calculate the level density of this doorway state, it's also zero at the Fermi energy. So that all is the same reason. You cannot fulfill at the same time the energy conservation here and the Pauli blocking. You have no space free for finite level density. What else to tell? Yes, let me show you now for the critical temperature a view graph. I have to see where I have it. Yes, here. So again here, in a little bit nicer writing, the four-body Schrödinger equation in medium with the Pauli blocking factors. Here is a graphical representation plus the five permutations. And you see that here's the critical temperature for the alpha particles at mu minus 7, it starts. So if you go up with mu, you go up also with density. Here is 10 to minus 4, 10 to minus 3, and so forth and so on. And then you go up with critical temperature. You reach about the maximum of 6 MeV. And then suddenly it breaks off at some maybe 10 MeV. And here you have the critical temperature of the deuteron. It starts at minus 1.1, slightly below zero, and then goes on and only fades away very far. There's no breakdown. The going down here is essentially related to the range of the force, the two-body force. So this is the effect. I mean, here it does not break down exactly at zero because we here are at finite temperature. And you certainly will be able to see that if you change the step functions here into Fermi function at finite temperature, you fill in here. You fill in here a bit. So it's still strongly suppressed at the Fermi energy, four times Fermi energy, but of course at finite temperature it doesn't go to zero. So that's why there is a little bit of overshoot, but still alpha particle condensation breaks down. And it breaks down essentially at a density which is about a tenth or a fifth of saturation density, which is the density where the alpha particles start essentially to overlap with their densities. So if I have an alpha particle density which looks something like that, and if you have such overlaps here, if this starts to happen, alpha particle condensation breaks down. Maybe it's time to make a little break and then we go on for finite nuclei. Okay, see you in a couple of minutes. maybe only one time.
So
Ja. Okay. Can I have some water to drink? It from me. Okay, let's go on with the second part of the lecture. Somebody asked me what has this level densities to do with the solution of the two particle or four particle problem. And why in the level density we also have to consider these Pauli blocking factors. Well, generally speaking, it is clear that the level density should go in one or way or the other, a solution of a Schrödinger equation, in particular two-body Schrödinger equation or four-body equation. But you can see also here, for example, that if you transform this Schrödinger equation in the corresponding Green's function equation, you have something like an integral equation, let's say two-body or four-body. You have a free propagator plus a free propagator, two or four, some interaction, and again the full propagator. So that's a general Green's function integral equation corresponding to an eigenvalue equation. And the free Green's function here, four body or two body, has essentially the imaginary part of this is some spectral function, or if you integrate over, it's the level density. So you see that one as the free part, here you have the free energies in the delta function, and here are the free energies. The free part contains as imaginary part essentially the level density. And so in this way, the level density, which is the imaginary part essentially of the free Green's function, and the real part you can get by a proportional relation. Is it okay? It's in this way that the level density enters as an essential part in the solution of the two-body or four-body problem. Okay, yes, so what did we learn from the first part of the lecture? We have learned that some sort of correlated two particle states, either bound or only correlated, bound if the chemical potential is negative, more or less unbound or in the continuum if the chemical potential is positive. For the two particle system, we have always superconductivity or superfluidity, even if the correlated two particle states are strongly overlapping. Overlapping, where I have it. No. Here. Right? In the upper part, this is typically what happens in a metal. A metal, the correlated part of the two electron wave function is hundreds of angstroms long, and they are completely intermingled and completely anti-symmetrized. This state must be completely antisymmetric, like I have written the antisymmetrizer. This is a very shorthand notation of full BCS theory. I have no time to. And the occupation numbers are like here, whereas we have seen that this is absolutely not the case if you have clusters which are higher in numbers of fermions, namely four-body cluster, alpha particle in nuclear physics, or more generally quartets in any other type of physics. And in that case, you have only more or less Bose-Einstein condensations as long as you really have binding of them. Binding means negative chemical potential. Of course, if you squeeze the gas of the alpha particles, because of the antisymmetrization, which they feel stronger and stronger, lose binding. And then at some point, the chemical potential goes through zero and wants to go to positive. But this is not possible contrary to the deuterons or to the electron correlation functions, like we have seen, yes, here, somewhere, no, sorry, I'll get mixed up, because here, you see the highest occupation for the alpha particles go up only to 0.35, and then chemical potential still can be slightly positive, but afterwards there's no solution anymore. Breaks down. Actually, what exactly happens at this breakdown of the alpha particles is not clear. This has not been investigated so far. Let me concentrate. Yes. At this point, how the quartet system breaks up here, maybe in a pair of two deuterons given alpha particle, this is not clear. Anyway, as you can imagine, the solution of a four-body Schrödinger equation, even in free space for free alpha particle, is not completely trivial. If you have these phase space factors in addition in the four-body problem, is a tough job, but in nuclear physics we have people who can do that, and such curves are the solution of the four-body problem with a realistic nuclear force in the medium, which means with the Pauli blocking. So this has to be retained from the lessons that this is the superfluidity or superconductivity scenario, and only the lower part prevails in the case of the alpha particles. So let us come to finite nuclei. I mean, once BCS theory, Bardeen, Cooper, and Schrieffer, I think in 1956, has been invented, and from one day to the other explained how superconductivity functions after 50 years of its discovery in 1911, Omnes has discovered superconductivity. Then immediately Bohr and Mandelson in nuclear physics, maybe 2 years later, they thought that such superconductivity, but it's not superconductivity, it's superfluidity in nuclei, can also play a role, and they translated the BCS formalism to superfluidity to nuclei. And what did they explain from superfluidity? Well, there is a strong indication that many nuclei are superfluid, which comes from the fact that you have a good part of the nuclei are deformed. For instance, already the beryllium 8, which is two alpha particles, is of course strongly deformed, and you find a nice rotational spectrum experimentally, which confirms this deformed two alpha particle state. Heavier nuclei, they are not, have not such alpha structure, as I told you, and maybe I didn't stress it enough, that heavier nuclei have not in the ground state this alpha structure, but they are in first good approximation something like a Slater determinant, which is a little bit more sophisticated, but essentially the Fermi gas, independent motion of nucleons in their proper mean field. Nuclei are self-bound drops of fermions. It's a very interesting object. You don't find this here. You have helium-3 drops, which are also fermions, but otherwise to find self-bound Fermi systems, finite fermions in nature, is very rare. Cold atoms, you trap the fermions in external electromagnetic potentials. They have similarities with nuclei, but the number of fermions is much larger than in nuclei. But nuclei are self-bound fermions. They create their own mean field. They create their own mean field, which holds them together in a very rough way. One could, for lighter nuclei, say this is harmonic oscillator, which we already discussed. In heavier nuclei, you have something what one calls a Wood-Sexton potential, which according to the constant density is also flat in the interior and goes to zero in a certain surface thickness, which reflects also the density distribution. And in addition, nuclei can be spherical. Of course, alpha particle is spherical. All doubly closed shell nuclei, because you fill in a complete quotation mark harmonic oscillator principal shell, you sum up of all magnetic quantum numbers, so necessarily you have a spherical object. But what one calls open shell nuclei, where a major harmonic oscillator shell is not completely filled, they most of the time get deformed. For instance, if they are open shell nuclei in neutrons and protons, I will not go into details why it's so, but as I said, many nuclei are deformed, and they have very nice rotational spectra. These are measured. So 0 plus, 2 plus, 4 plus, 6 plus, 8 plus, and so on. I don't know how high up they go, the highest one, but they go over 30, 40 h bar omega. One can deduce the moment of inertia. This is a J times J plus 1 spectrum, like for any rotating quantum system. And one can, from the spectrum, which is over 2 times, well, let's call it theta, moment of inertia, this gives you the spectrum, one can deduce the moment of inertia. The moment of inertia for a non-interacting Fermi gas, it may be a little bit counterintuitive, but it's extremely close to a rigid moment of inertia. This comes from the fact that if you rotate a wave function is a quantum mechanical wave function, is a rather rigid object. So you turn a wave function without deforming the wave function. So if you calculate a moment of inertia of a non-interacting or a mean field Slater determinant object, you get essentially a rigid moment of inertia, like a rigid body. Whereas if you measure this moment of inertia, you get something which is theta is approximately seat are rigid over factor two or three or four. So it's the measured moment of inertia is a factor three to four smaller than the one of a rigid body. And this comes essentially from the fact that if you turn an ellipsoid full of water, if you rotate it, then this inscribed sphere of water does not participate in the rotation. So only the parts which are outside rotate. And this is, of course, gives rise to a moment of inertia which is much smaller. This is understandable. And so this was essentially one indication that also finite nuclei are superfluid in essentially the same way as one has superconductivity in metals. There are other indications like even odd effect and so on and so forth. I don't want to go, but this is one of the most spectacular indications that finite nuclei are superfluid. Yes, what I wanted to say. Well, yes. So this is an indication that superfluidity from infinite matter, one has strong arguments that also neutron stars, the neutrons are superfluid there. I cannot tell why. There are some phenomenon which one calls glitches, where the rotational frequency suddenly speeds up in neutron stars, and one has strong reasons to believe that the neutrons in the neutron stars are superfluid. So this practically infinite, can be considered as an infinite system, like electron gas in metals. But also, as I just said, superfluidity can have its own manifestation in finite nuclei. So now, question is, of course, we have seen that certainly, and people agree on that, that nuclear matter at low density is not stable, but clusters, and for instance, may cluster into alpha particles. Why? Because if density is very low, you should maybe know that equation of state of nuclear matter is strongly E over A. Has for low densities at such a density, here's something like rho zero. So, and maybe here's zero. If you dilute the system, you lose strongly, it goes more or less quadratically around this equilibrium point. If you expand the nucleus, you lose much binding energy, and it comes to a critical, and I will show you a picture, it comes to a critical low density where it is energetically more favorable that the nuclear matter clusters into alpha particles or even heavier nuclei, where they, with the finite system, still gain the total binding energy of a real nucleus. So there's some equilibrium between you lose here energy, but if you then have, say, 10 alpha particles instead of 10 times 40 nucleons, calcium 40, it's energetically favorable. The alpha particles gain their 7 MeV binding energy, and this is more binding than here in the low density regime. So it is absolutely accepted in the nuclear community that nuclear matter at low density breaks up in clusters, and as we have seen, there's a good chance that it breaks up into an alpha particle condensate. So what about now real finite nuclei? Yes, we have seen this already. Let me check this. Well, this is an old cartoon from Phil Siemens where he makes over many orders of magnitude phase-based diagram as a function of temperature and baryon density. And you see, this was in, oh, I don't know, 1980 or something like that. He supposed already that at very low temperature and a very low density, you can abose a condensate of alpha particles. And then you go up, you have neutrons, protons, deutons, alpha gas. And in neutron stars, if you go up, you have different, this density, you have different droplets and what one calls bubbles or spaghetti formation of different layers of protons and neutrons and so forth. Then comes a superfluid of protons and neutrons, maybe a liquid crystal. If you go still up in density, you get a quark, you get a transition from these quark clusters. They also, if you go up in density, they lose the cluster structure and the nucleon soup, when you press them, it goes over into free quarks or free quark and gluons. So this comes here to a quark gluon plasma and so forth. So this is more or less relatively all the same physics. You have strongly bound clusters. If you squeeze them to high density, of course, the binding energy of the clusters because of the Pauli principle lose goes away. You go to a free fermion soup, fermion either quark soup at very high densities or nucleon soup or nucleon gas if you squeeze the alpha particles. Okay, what else is we have seen? Yes, I mean, now we want to see what's going on if we have to the beryllium 8 a third alpha particle. I mean, of course, we know that the ground state, the third alpha particle, this gives some extra attraction. We have some sort of three alpha particle binding energy, extra conduction. This makes that it does not stay into this configuration, which one would get if one puts a third alpha particle here. But the system, one should realize also one thing, that this system, with respect to an ordinary ground state nucleus, has a very low density. I mean, an alpha particle has a usual, more or less usual density of a nucleus. But since they are more or less four fermions apart, if you calculate the average density of the object, it's by a factor three or four lower than the usual density of a nuclear ground state. And carbon 12 in its ground state has certainly a usual density of what I have shown to you of this type. It's a very small nucleus, carbon 12, so this plateau here is not very pronounced, but certainly here it's around the usual nuclear density at equilibrium. Whereas such an object would have more or less the density of the beryllium 8 in carbon 12. The point is now that carbon 12 has ground state collapsed, but there is an excited state in carbon 12, which is the first zero plus excited state, which for a long time people could not explain. Which is a very famous state. So we have in carbon 12, we have the ground state, and we have an excited state, the first, so the nomenclature goes, that is the first zero plus state, this is the second zero plus state, and this lies 7.6 5 MeV above the ground state. So this state is very famous for certain reasons, which I tell you in a moment, but could not be explained up to the 70s, 80s from normal nuclear theory. I mean, there are several mean field theories, and there are more sophisticated approaches for nuclear physics, like shell model diagonalizations, huge matrix diagonalizations, Hamiltonian, and diagonalizes. And one found many states of carbon 12, but this state never came. The first excited state of zero plus state in carbon 12 came 30, 40 MeVs high, and this was out of scale, and people could not explain what kind of nature this state had. So, yeah, and this state now has a very famous story, because this state was predicted by an astrophysicist at a time which was where this state did not exist, by astrophysicist Fred Hoyle. His name is Fred Hoyle. This is Fred Hoyle, who predicted this state on purely anthropic grounds. Because you may know that in the universe, 12 is very abundant. For example, our body and all plants and all is full of carbon 12. And one could not understand why there's so much carbon 12 in the universe. So Hoyle, he said, to produce carbon 12 is not so easy, because between alpha particle and carbon 12, there's no stable nucleus. So let me see. No, somewhere here. No. Here it comes. Here. I'm sorry, I've lost my source file, so the slides are not in order. So if you look at this scheme here, you have here the alpha particle. You have beryllium-8. I told you that on nuclear scales, beryllium-8 is practically stable. It's 92 keV, unstable, but has a lifetime of 10 to the minus 17 seconds, a width only of eV, which is atomic scales. So it's very long-lived on nuclear scales, but on absolute scales, 10 to the minus 17, of course, as soon as you produce, it's already gone. And Hoyle said, well, if you have two alphas which form a beryllium-8, there must be a third alpha to form a carbon-12. How is it possible that this reaction produces so much carbon-12? He said, the only possibility is that the energy, or the energy of the excited state of carbon-12 must just hit, there must be a resonance state in carbon-12, and he calculated from the temperature of the sun and so forth in the universe that he almost hit is right. He made a prediction of 7.7 MeV for this state on purely these grounds, that we have so much carbon-12 in the universe, and it's the reason for life on Earth. Then Fowler, a couple of years later, famous nuclear physicist also. What was the first name? I got Fowler. Fowler. A couple of years later, in Caltech, he measured, he searched for this zeroplastate at these early days to find zeroplastates experimentally were not so easy because they decay not directly by gammas, maybe double gamma and so forth. But he found that. His crew found it and practically exactly at the state, at the energy which was predicted. I think is the only state in nuclear physics which was predicted on such anthropic grounds, as one says today. So the fact that there is a resonance state in carbon 12 such that these entrance reactions, beryllium 8, I remember, is very short-lived on absolute scales, plus an alpha, still lives long enough so that it can enter via this in this resonance state and then decay to the ground state. This is then possible. So since then, this state is now called the Hoyle state. And as I told you, it was for a very long time, it was a very mysterious state. What is the structure of this state? No ordinary nuclear physics calculation by any means could reproduce this state. So in 1966, there was the first suggestion by Morinaga. That, of course, suggested by this reaction, triple, one calls this the triple alpha reaction. Two alphas go in beryllium 8, unstable, but nevertheless, plus a third alpha particle goes over into this second zero plus state. He said this state may have a three alpha chain character, where not only with beryllium, two alphas align, but one has such an object where three alphas align. In a way, it's a suggestive idea. Two alphas give the smallest chain you can imagine, and then you just add a third alpha particle to get a three alpha particle chain. This idea did not withstand further investigation. It was in the 70s, as a first person with some theory, Hisashi Horiuchi, Japanese, by the way, are very active since many years, 30, 40 years in nuclear cluster theory. He invented more or less a phenomenological theory, which is called orthonormal condition method, which is essentially a theory where they consider alpha particles as elementary bosons, and the bosons interact via an effective boson-boson interaction, which can be adjusted to alpha scattering data and so forth. So one knows something about such an effective boson-boson interaction. And he considered such a three-body problem of three elementary alpha particles, putting in a little bit of the Pauli principle. I will not explain to you what is this. And he could explain with the phenomenological alpha-alpha force, he could explain the position of, and also the electromagnetic transition probably, of this state, of this so-called Hoyle state, and he concluded it is not a chain state, but it is sort of a loosely bound alpha gas state where the alpha particles are all in relatively S state. So if you have a beryllium, the beryllium is in a zero plus state, so it is homogeneously distributed, and the third alpha particle turns around the beryllium also in an S wave, so the whole object is a three alpha object, not a chain state, but some sort of spherical three alpha gas state, which where the, for instance, where the alpha particles are in such a state where the such a diluted state, I will show you why one thinks that the Hoyle state has a density which is essentially lower than the ground state of carbon 12, which is a Fermi gas state, essentially a dense state, whereas this has a volume which is 3 to 4 times bigger than the ground state, in such a way that it gives space enough to that the three alpha particles form, like we have seen in infinite nuclear matter, that at low density you have the alpha condensation. And one can then, as an extrapolation, assume that heavier N alpha nuclei may also have a low density phase where you have more alpha particles. And we will discuss about this in more detail a little bit later. Maybe, and this Horiuchi, in his early work, he did not use the word condensation, but if you think of a loosely bound three alpha gas state where the alpha particles are in relative S state, actually it's not far away from the notion of an alpha condensate. It was in 2001 where I published with three other colleagues, notably Horiuchi, Tosaki, and Gerd Repke from Rostock in Germany, and where we made an ansatz which of this type which I showed you there, but instead of deuteron alpha particles, I had it written also somewhere here, is still the remnant of my alpha particle condensate wave function. We made such an ansatz and could also then explain very nicely this Hoyle state. So the Hoyle state, as we will see in more detail, can to a good approximation be seen as a three alpha particle condensate where the alpha particles occupy with their center of mass motion the lowest state in a sort of a harmonic oscillator, mean field, boson potential, where the three alpha particles are all here in the lowest state here, instead of 6 or 8 or what, we have 3 here. Yeah, then, wait a minute, this, no. Yeah, this in came, I mean, the idea came essentially from the fact that in the meantime, in 1996 or somewhere, people achieved to trap bosonic atoms in standing electromagnetic waves. I mean, electromagnetic waves, you can sort of fabricate electromagnetic wells with lasers. And since the atoms most of the time have a magnetic moment, they achieved in ultra cold cooling of these systems to trap bosons in these artificial potential wells. And then they trapped it not only tens or hundreds, but thousands and ten thousands and even up to millions. And you see here a picture where they successively decrease the temperature. Here's the temperature is relatively high, and you here see a strong peak coming up. And for bosons, the mean field there, I didn't tell you. For bosons, since the mean field, the bosons go all in the lowest state here. So the mean field has only one state. So as we have seen, the Ri is equal to sum over J V of Ri minus R integral over R presence, probability of presence here over I over J. But since the J's are all the same, you have the zero wave function times the factor n. So this is the probability distribution of a condensate. You have all alpha particles or boson in the same wave function, and since they're the same wave function, but you have n alpha particles, you multiply this probability with a factor n, and here in this case it was maybe 100,000 or what. So you see this probability distribution almost macroscopically in these blue peaks. So this is a function of temperature from left to right. You decrease the temperature to something millikelvin or extremely low temperature, almost zero, absolute zero. But you see these blue peaks are the magnification of the square of this wave function of the boson. Now, in nuclear physics, we have, of course, much less bosons, but still there is some analogy between this Bose-Einstein condensation of atoms, and they do now also with fermions, and they see fermion distribution and so forth. So I want to go a little bit the historical way. I told you that in the early 70s, Horiuchi explained with a phenomenological boson model the Hoyle state, and he said it's a loosely bound gas state of three alphas, mostly in a relative S state. Then, in the middle of the 1970s, again, two Japanese theoreticians, I told you that they were considering very strongly cluster physics, whose names are Kamimura and co-authors, and Uegaki and co-authors, almost at the same time. Kamimura, 1975 approximately, and et al, I should say, et al, and Uegaki et al, both with slightly different but fully microscopic approach, namely a 12 nucleon wave function. And I will shortly explain you how they did achieve to explain the Hoyle state in carbon 12. So how did they do? Fowler, you remember? Yeah, I should say what? Ah, Peter, okay. P. Fowler. I should still tell you a story about this. So Fowler discovered, or experimentally, 2 or 3 years later, after the prediction of Fred Hoyle, this famous first excited zero-plus state in carbon 12, Fowler afterwards got the Nobel Prize, but Fred Hoyle not. So as often the history goes, Fred Hoyle was very angry about this and always was very unhappy up to the end of his life. He died a couple of years back, and so this was a little bit a sad story. He more or less invented the whole thing, but Fowler has done many other things in nuclear physics. Maybe this was the reason why he got finally the Nobel Prize and Hoyle not. Okay, we found that this chain state for Hoyle state is not the thing to be considered. So then these two gentlemen made the following, or at least Kamimura first. Uegaki made a slightly different ansatz. So they imagined that this Hoyle state must be as an essential ingredient alpha particles. That was the idea, similar to beryllium-8. So Kamimura made following ansatz for the three alpha state. He said this must be built up of three alpha particles, and three alpha particles in the intrinsic system. So intrinsic system means translational invariant alpha particles, and the center of mass is a different story. He imagined that the intrinsic alpha particles, we know that with harmonic oscillator wave function, zero S harmonic oscillator wave functions, if we adjust one parameter with modern functionals, we very well can reproduce the alpha particle under the condition that the center of mass motion is correctly treated. So for one alpha particle, they made the following ansatz. Up to a normalization, it was proportional to the minus R1 minus R2 squared plus R1 minus R3 squared plus R1 minus R4 squared plus R2 minus R3 squared plus R3 minus R4 squared over some Witz parameter squared. So this is a Gaussian which only depends on the relative coordinates, R1 minus R2, R1 minus R3, R1 minus R4, R2. So there are five combinations, R2 minus R3, R3 minus R4. Did I forget something? Pardon me? There should be another one, yes. There should be six, yes. Which one did I forget? Oh, yeah. I forgot here one. R2 minus R4 squared plus R3 minus R4 squared over some Witz parameter. Okay, we have six now. You are out of four. You can make six combinations of relative coordinates. 3 × 4/2 = 6. So R1 minus R2, R1 minus R3, R1 minus R4. Then you go to the next one, R2 minus R3, R2 minus R4. And last one, R3 minus R4. Over. So you know, one knows, if one takes this for the alpha particle, which has about a density which looks already Gaussian because it's so small, if one takes this as a variational parameter and calculates the expectation value of some Hamiltonian with some force, which one more or less, phenomenological force, which one more or less knows, then this gives excellent reproduction of the density, energy, and more or less usual properties of the alpha particle. So Kamimura imagined that there are three alpha particles of this type with such a Witz parameter, which he thought he will keep it at this three alpha particle value, like a three alpha value, because he imagined that the three alpha particles will not lose much of their shape. I go the other way, always the wrong way. Yes, if you look at the Hoyle state there, you imagine that the alpha particles are essentially like Horiuchi found, that is more or less a loosely bound system of three alpha particles. But then, for the center of mass, he thought that the alpha particles cannot move on very small scales. The alpha particles should move on the whole system of the nucleus, as big as the nucleus is. So he made a center of mass wave function. He proposed a center of mass wave function, which is also I mean, in principle, there are three center of mass coordinates, but to make it translational invariant, you have only two center of mass coordinates. Namely, if you have three alpha particles, you can have xi1, which is a relative coordinate, and then to the third alpha particle is xi2. So this is alpha, alpha, alpha. And the third center of mass coordinate is a total center of mass coordinate, which has to be eliminated in a three-body calculation. You have only two, what one calls Jacobi coordinates, which makes then the system translational invariant. So this is a microscopic ansatz he made, which is 12 nucleons, and the 12 nucleon wave function is completely translational invariant, as it should be. I mean, it should not depend whether the you consider the carbon 12 here or here, a Hamiltonian, how many particles you consider, is always with a translational invariant two-body force, is always the wave function should be totally translational invariant. So he made this ansatz, of course, to up to a normalization constant. And there were some phenomenological two-body, two nucleon forces, what one calls Volkov force. Volkov force is some Gaussian ansatz also. One knew from alpha-alpha scattering that this force reproduces relatively well the scattering of alpha-alpha. So he took that force. The force depends also a little bit on spin and isospin, never mind. So he calculated with this three alpha ansatz, Hamiltonian, three alpha, over the norm, three alpha. He calculated the energy, and he made a variational calculation with respect to this center of mass wave function. This, as I told you, he is supposed to be fixed with B value, this relatively small alpha width of a free alpha particle, whereas in the center of mass motion, of course, was hidden the center of mass motion over the whole nuclear volume, which is 3 to 4 times bigger, as we will see, as the carbon 12 ground state. So this is an extremely difficult three-body problem. Already, if we had pure bosons, you would end up here without these alpha particle wave functions. You would end up with a three-body boson equation, and the three-body equation is always not completely trivial to solve on a computer, even nowadays. But at this time, it was an extreme exploit that they solved this three-body wave function from a minimization of this energy, integrating out all the internal degrees of relative wave function of the alpha particles, so that at the end he stayed only with a Schrödinger type of equation for this center of mass wave function. I can write up a little bit the equation. We should stop maybe here, and I continue tomorrow in explaining a little bit how in detail he calculated this. So anyway, it was a great exploit at that time in 1975 with such an idea to calculate the Hoyle state successfully. Okay, we continue tomorrow. Yeah. I should take off.